Welcome back to Trinity Project. My name is Evan, and today we're continuing our discussion. We are moving to the third topic, and we're going to discuss about the biblical mysteries, also known as the biblical quantum creation. And we're just going to see what the Bible says about the creation of the heaven and the earth. And we're just going to compare with mainstream science, and I'm going to let you decide what you're going to believe. And for this video, I prepared an article from one website, and a really good video from the YouTube channel Rob Skiba. By the way, Rob Skiba is a Bible-believing Christian, just like the other people that I'm promoting in my videos. And we're going to let him talk more about biblical creationism or biblical cosmology. So let's start and see how many Bible verses are in total we're talking about the creation of heaven and the earth. So I'm going to read an article from the website flatearthdoctrine.com. So there are over 240 Bible verses for the geocentric stationary and flat earth universe model. There is not one, I repeat, not one scripture when used in context which supports a spherical-shaped earth or an earth that spins or moves. 9 Bible verses say that earth does not move. Instead, the earth is fixed, stable, and established. That is 1 Chronicles 16, Psalm 33, 9, Psalm 93, 1, Psalm 96, 10, Psalm 104, 5, Psalm 119, 88, and 90, Isaiah 14, Isaiah 45, and Zechariah 1. There are literally hundreds, if not thousands, of scientific proofs that disprove the spinning sphere-shaped Earth and prove the stationary and flat Earth. Here are just a few undisputable flat Earth proofs. Number 1, level water. Number 2, level horizon. Number 3, aircraft never accounts for motion of Earth. Number 4, railroad tracks and bridges. Number 5, airplanes and submarines. And number 6, gravity theory. The heliocentric universe model is from man, not God. NASA has lied about our cosmology to discredit and invades God's world. In a world where people believe they were created from an ape and that they don't know what gender they are, correct? The correct account of creation from the Bible is more relevant than ever. Or, in other words, let God be true, but every man a liar. Romans 3, 4. So, let's see what the Bible is telling us about the creation of the world. So, these Bible verses are divided in several groups. I'm just going to read the name of the groups, and I'm going to leave the link in the description box below. So, Earth created before the sun. Universe is complete, not ever expand. Earth measurements unknown. Earth is a disk or a circle, not a ball. Earth measure with a line, not a curve. A plane can't exist on a ball. Only a flat slash level surface of which Yeshua, as known as Jesus, stood upon. Paths are straight, not curved. Waters are straight, not curved. Earthquakes shake earth and does not move. Earth is fixed and unmovable. Be still and know that I am God. Earth has pillars and hangs on nothing. Earth has a face, a geometrical flat surface. Waters have a face. Sky has a face. Earth has ends. Earth has 4 corners and 4 quarters. 1 firmament or dome. Sun moves, not the earth. Sun stops moving. Sun moves backwards. Moon has its own line. Pay attention. The best proof that the earth is a disk is the moon. High altitude perspectives. Everyone see Jesus. New Jerusalem, the huge cube. Breath spread out flat of the earth. Voice of creation goes out in a line through all the earth. Matthew's Bible from 1537 says, flatter creation worshipers. God's world is always faithful and true. So this was like an introduction before I'm going to play the video, which Rob Skiba is going to explain you in details about these specific groups where the Bible is talking about the biblical creationism. So let's go on.
That's quite a long time period, right, that it's covered in Genesis. So you almost have to think of Genesis as like a cliff notes of human history, from creation all the way up until, you know, just before the Exodus starts, right? That's a lot of time, and it covered a lot of ground. Of course, it all starts in Genesis chapter 1, so let's go ahead and read through this here. In the beginning, God created the heaven and the earth, and the earth was without form and void, and darkness was upon the face of the deep. And the Spirit of God moved upon the face of the waters. And God said, let there be light, and there was light. God saw the light that it was good, and God divided the light from the darkness. And God called the light day, and the darkness he called night. And the evening and the morning were the first day. And God said, let there be a firmament in the midst of the waters, and let it divide the waters from the waters. And God made the firmament, divided the waters which were under the firmament from the waters which were above the firmament. And it was so. And God called the firmament heaven, and the evening and the morning were the second day. Wow. A lot of stuff going on right there. So let's look at the word firmament. Strong's number 7549, it's the word rakia. We see that it's an expanse, that it is solid. It is beaten out. When you see in the book of Job, it is a solid structure. Some say as of ice, a support base. We see that it's holding up God's throne. So it is regarded by the Hebrews as solid, supporting the waters above, in the verses that you see there, the Brown's, Driver, Briggs, Concordance. When you look at Job 37:18, you see in multiple English translations a variety of ways of describing this thing, but all essentially saying the same thing. This is a hard structure, a mirror cast of bronze, a bronze mirror, a cast metal mirror, molten looking glass in the King James. This is a hard structure up there. When we look at the sky in Amos chapter 9, verse 6, it talks about a vaulted dome. It's a different word used there, aguda, if I'm pronouncing that right, a structure fitted together. But we see in Ezekiel that this structure, this firm structure, there was a likeness of the throne on top of it. We see likewise in Isaiah 66:1, heaven is my throne and the earth is my footstool. There's something firm up there upon which his throne is sitting. We see in Genesis 1:8, he called the firmament the rakia, the beaten down metallic structure, heaven, shemayim. It is he that sitteth upon the circle of the earth, and the inhabitants thereof are as grasshoppers. And he stretches out the heavens, the shemayim, as a curtain, and spreadeth them out as a tent to dwell in. Now, in the context of Isaiah's time, tent, this is what you might consider like a Bedouin tent structure, probably more like something like this, a yurt, which is found throughout multiple cultures in the ancient world. Or even today, we might look at as something like this, a dome tent. Regardless of which idea of a tent you look at, this is what they're saying, that the heavens are stretched out like a tent. So we have the word like or as being a metaphor, right? But tents are always stretched out over a flat surface. Interesting. So we continue. What's placed inside the tent? Genesis 1, beginning of verse 9. God said, let the waters under the heaven be gathered together into one place, and let the dry land appear. And it was so. And God called the dry land earth, and the gathering together of the waters called he seas. And God saw that it was good. And God said, let the earth bring forth grass, and herb yielding seed, and the fruit tree yielding fruit after his kind, whose seed is in itself upon the earth. And it was so. And the earth brought forth grass, and herb yielding seed after his kind, and the tree yielding fruit whose seed was in itself after his kind. And God saw that it was good. And the evening and the morning were the third day. How did the dry land appear? Genesis just says the dry land appeared. But when we go through the Old Testament texts of the prophets, we see a more definition as to how that happened. Job actually predates Genesis. Job was written before Genesis. In Job 38, he talks about the laying of foundations. The earth was laid out with foundations. We see that when that was happening in verse 7, the morning stars sang together, and all the sons of God shouted for joy. Please note, the sons of God in this context are angels, not the sons of Seth. Keep that in mind as we progress into Genesis chapter 6. because this is the understanding we need to have of the phrase, the sons of God. We see in 1 Samuel 2:8 that the pillars of the earth are the Lord's, and he has set the world upon them. The world's sitting on pillars. The foundations were discovered. You have pillars and foundations. It's all through the Old Testament. Psalm 102:25, of old, thou hast laid the foundation of the earth. Proverbs 8:27, when he established the heavens, I was there. When he inscribed a circle on the face of the deep, the dry land appeared out of the face of the deep in Genesis. So we get more detail here from these various authors, and there are others. I just didn't have the ability to fit them all on one slide right here. But these are really good to get us started. When we see that the dry land appeared as a result of Yahuwah inscribing a circle on the face of the deep, look up the Hebrew word for inscribe, we see that the Hebrew word is chakak, or kalkak, or however you pronounce it, I'm not sure. But basically it means to engrave or to carve something into something else, as if chiseling into like the stone for like the Ten Commandments. Please note, you cannot carve a ball into stone. However, you can inscribe a circle into stone, which is what the text says. The word circle is the word shug, which means circle. When we continue to look at this, we see that Isaiah is one of the last authors to write in this regard. A lot of people, when they're describing earth, want to go to Isaiah 40:22, but you have to realize Isaiah is building upon all the people who had written before him, like Job, and like David, and like Solomon, and like Moses. So when we get to Isaiah 40:22, which is a verse I have used myself to describe the earth, it says, it is he that sitteth upon the circle of the earth. Well, I took Hebrew 101 twice, so that should give you an indication of my aptitude for learning Hebrew. And some may say, I don't even have that great a handle on English. Whatever the case may be, language 101, words mean things. And what's interesting about this, especially if you're a King James only type, Isaiah knew the difference between ball and a circle. In Isaiah 22:18, he talks about a ball. The Hebrew word used there is dur, ball. He chose a different word when he described the earth, and staying consistent with the other authors who came before him in that regard. So Isaiah clearly knew the difference. The King James translators knew the difference. Now the question is, do we know the difference? Google helps you if you want to Google ball. Or a Google circle, you might get images such as this. So some say when God looked down on the earth, he saw a circle. Well, if he's looking down from the north, you don't get a circle. The only time you get a circle is if you're either sitting on the sun or directly in between the sun and the earth. If you're looking from any other direction, you get something like that when you're looking down. So I'm just going to put this out there for some consideration. I'm not telling you what I believe. I am just putting this out there for consideration. This is a ball. This is a circle. Take with it whatever you want. Here's what really got me messed up in all this. Why am I even talking about this stuff? Because I believe, as all of you guys indicated, that we should take the Bible literally. Well, the problem is, when I started to do that with regard to this particular subject, I got myself in a lot of trouble. And some of you know what I'm talking about. You've been following my YouTube channel and Facebook page. This one really got to me, though, is when we get to the fourth day, and he talks about the creation of the sun, moon, and stars. And it says in three places that he put them in the firmament. Now, I used to teach the same thing that is taught by Kent Hovind and Carl Baugh and others, that the firmament was a canopy, an ice canopy, that surrounded the earth. And it's a great theory. And that, you know, so the theory goes, something impacted it probably, and the firmament disintegrated. Windows of heaven, as it were, opened up, and the canopy disintegrated over a period of 40 days, 40 nights, and it rained down on the earth. Great theory. Pretty awesome. There's a couple problems with it, though. Number one, we have Psalm 148, verse 4, says, in a post-flood context, praise him, ye heavens of heavens, and ye waters that be, at the time of David, above the heavens. There's still water up there. Number one. But this is the bigger problem. When you look up the Hebrew there, you see in the red, it's Bevipia, I'm not sure how you pronounce it. The point is, there's a letter bait preceding the Hebrew word. I learned this much in Hebrew 101, taking it twice, that when a word is preceded with the prefix of bait, it means in, not outside and around, which is what the Kent Hovind and Carl Baugh thesis requires. the earth surrounded in the firmament, and the sun, moon, and stars outside of it. So I saw a video Ken Hovind did on the two firmaments, and he acknowledged that this is a problem. So he did a whole video talking about, well, the first one was destroyed, but there's one on the outside perimeter of the universe, whatever that means. And I'm like, dude, book, chapter, verse on that, man.
I can't prove this at all. Here's the Hovind theory. When God first made the earth, there was earth and space. Then, in day two, he put a crystalline canopy above the atmosphere and where Adam and Eve lived and the birds fly, maybe 10 miles up, wild guess. And he must have put a second crystalline firmament beyond the stars. People, nobody knows where the star, where does the universe end? And what's on the other side? I don't know. But it says, the waters that be above the heavens, there are in answer to the legitimate criticism that the birds fly in the firmament and the stars are in the firmament, there may be two crystalline canopies and two firmaments. Paul said in 2 Corinthians chapter 12, he was caught up to the third heaven. Hovind theory would be the first heaven is the atmosphere that we're breathing up, maybe used to be maybe 10 miles thick, and now it's expanded out to 50 or 60 miles. Okay. It used to have an atmosphere, I'm going to pick a number and say 10 miles thick, a layer of ice, maybe three fingers thick, like Josephus and the Jews taught, have always taught. Then stars with bazillions of stars in it going who knows how far, and then another crystalline firmament. And beyond that, I don't know. But Paul was caught up to the third heaven. So the first heaven would be where the birds fly, the second heaven where the stars are, and the third heaven where God lives. Best I can figure out.
I love Ken Hovind. I consider him a brother. He is largely responsible for the problems I'm having right now because he came through my little Baptist church when I was in my late teens, early 20s, did his creation week-long seminar, Creation versus Evolution. I got his six VHS set. Remember VHS back in the day? It's like 12 hours of Ken Hovind creation stuff. I dubbed it all to audio cassette, would listen to it religiously in my car until I practically had it memorized and would teach it myself. I loved all that stuff. And he's the one that taught me, he and others, that this is our source for truth. And of course, he's King Tech only. This is our source for truth, and we can take it literally. Okay, brother, that's what I'm trying to do. And we're running into problems with that idea of the firmament being an ice canopy. If you take it literally, from Genesis to Revelation, the earth is consistently described by Holy Spirit-inspired authors as something like this, where you basically end up with a fixed, not moving, spinning, or orbiting earth that is circular with edges, and it has corners, pillars, foundations, etc. And it's under a dome within which the sun, moon, and stars are placed on day four. Now, I created this model just trying to take the Bible literally. I'm going, okay, if I just read the text for what it says, and I didn't have any preconceived notions in my mind reading the text, what would I come up with? And that's what I came up with. Something set on foundations, circular, carved, in a circle, with a dome within which the sun, moon, and stars are placed. And it seemed to fit all the descriptions that I could see, like Isaiah 66:1, etc. And when I put this drawing out on the internet, somebody sent me this picture of a footstool, and I'm going, wow, that looked almost exactly like the depiction that I came up with just going through the various descriptions. Now, that's the inside of a bigger structure as I put more descriptives to the model, where I believe it's something along these lines, again, taking the scriptures literally, where there are other scriptures that talks about God walking on the circle of heaven. So I've got a circular platform over the dome, which would serve like as a footstool. His throne is up there on the top. And down below is this thing that's circular with a dome set on pillars. Okay, let's go a little crazier here. What about Job 26:7? He stretches out the north over the empty space and place and hangeth the earth on nothing. See? Aha! Job proves the earth is hanging in space. I've used that scripture myself numerous times. See? That proves it. The earth's hanging in space. Well, the problem is Job had a few things to say even prior to Job 26. In Job 9:6, he acknowledges the pillars of the earth. We see in Job 38, where he's talking about the foundations and all that stuff and laying the foundation. Other authors, in 1 Samuel, we see the pillars of the earth are the Lord's, and he has set the world upon the pillars. Huh. So could it be then that Job's not contradicting himself or others, but there's another way of looking at this? I think Job is confirming that the earth is hanging on no thing. It is not hanging on or from anything. In other words, all through the scriptures we see over and over and over again that it is set on pillars. So if I said to you, I'm in want for nothing, you would understand, well, Rob doesn't need anything. Right? Well, I think that's in the context of what Job himself has said in chapter 9 as well as in 38, as well as other scriptures, that he's saying the earth's not hanging on anything. Because all the authors are telling you it's set on pillars. It's on foundations. Now let's revisit what I started with, the three responses. Let's do a little checkup on you. What? Are you out of your mind? I can see the progression. I'm not oblivious to it. Go buy stock in tinfoil, dude. You're a stupid idiot. Okay. What did I say? Search and see if these things be true. Don't believe me. I'm just reading scripture to you up here. Remember? Prove and test all things. Keep doing it. Let's go. How many of you have heard of this game, Whisper Down the Lane? Right? We've all heard it. We played it as a kid, right? Who is most likely to have the truth? The one closest or the one farthest away from the original source of information? All right. So if we imagine these six individuals here as 6,000 years of human history, the problem is when you go to the one closest to the source material, all through the ancient world, they're depicting the earth like this. They're all doing it. Not just the Hebrews, the Sumerians, the Babylonians, even the Greeks until about 200 BC or so, the Egyptians, all of them had this worldview of the cosmos. This is another graphic somebody did depicting the various verses, and these aren't even all the verses, but the various verses that support this idea or at least indicate this idea. Now, I produced a video some of you may have seen a while back called Flat Earth, A Doctor and the Village Idiot. And I'm the village idiot in that story. And in that story, I was saying, okay, when I started doing this and posting videos and showing this stuff, of course, everybody thought I was an idiot, lost my mind, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. So then I found a highly respected individual, Dr. Michael Heiser. Some of you may know him. He's a Semitic language expert. He's the go-to guy everybody usually goes to when they think I'm crazy. Skiba says this, what do you say? But what was interesting is in his video, he does a whole 25-minute long presentation, about 20, 25 minutes or so, where he goes through the scriptures line by line, and he starts and says, if we take the scriptures literally, this is what you end up with. And he's on staff at Logos Bible Software, which is staffed by a lot of very intelligent people with letters after their name. And they acknowledge in this very expensive software, one of the premier software, Bible study softwares that you can buy on the market today, they have this graphic right here, created by Logos Bible Software, showing that if you take a literal view of the scriptures, this was the Hebraic concept.
Okay, guys. So, if we take the Bible literally, we will realize that what God is telling us about the biblical creation is completely different of what the mainstream science taught us in school. So you can believe whatever you want to believe, but if you're a Christian, if you're a Bible-believing Christian like me, then you're going to take the Bible literally and you're going to start to study this. And you're going to realize that you're going to have to go back in the ancient time and see how the ancient Hebrews describe the cosmos according to the book of Genesis and the whole Bible. So I want to apologize because I'm not able to play this video on my television because of the light reflection, but I'm going to provide you the links in the description box below so you can see for yourself. Okay, guys, thanks for watching. God bless all of you, and by next time, see you soon. Bye-bye.